Tonight, in my journey to the roots of British taste, I'm asking why an ancient Mediterranean style is loved by so many of us in this country today. Well, very nice to meet you.
Very nice to see you.
And I'll be finding out how the interior design business really got started.
Fantastic formality with the window arrangement.
It's a great thing to see. It does say taste, yes.
Very irresistible, of course. I'm gagging to do it.
We're talking ordinary objects with extraordinary histories. My journey to the origins of our classical tastes starts in Georgian East London.
I really love Georgian architecture and 18th century architecture. Clean lines, the simplicity of it. This house is 1805. It's taking its references right back to Rome.
It's extraordinary coming from all that hustle and bustle into this very quiet Georgian feeling environment. But I assume that that was probably going on 200 years ago.
I think it would be busier still. Yeah. Horses and carts, lots of noise, smells.
You're not very Georgian.
No. No, I'm a 20th century man.
You actually feel that Georgian is something that can be updated and
yes.
can be part of modern living.
Yeah.
What you are doing here is you're, you know, these are very, very, very historical looking colours in a very historical finish.
I like to use a dead flat oil paint. Mm. It's not unlike the paint they used. It doesn't reflect all the imperfections.
Yeah.
Again, it has a calmness for me, instead of getting all these sort of little lights shining against the imperfections.
Well, that sort of suburban obsession with gloss paint that, you know...
Yeah, which I hate.
Yeah, I can see that. What in here is original? What in here is stuff that you've put in?
This panelling on this wall over here is original to the house, and the floorboards are. They're wide, 9-inch floorboards. A pine, which was imported from the Baltic. The ceiling is original, and it has an original cornice, and there's a bit of the cornice has come down. It's going to get cleaned and repaired, and so it's to do with eating and food.
I think that is, without wine and food, love grows cold. Without grape and grain.
Yeah, I could believe...
love grows cold.
I agree with that.
Yeah, well, I think there's no person in the country that wouldn't agree with
that.
Well,
there are some teachers.
Yes, but maybe they don't know love. Is history important to you?
Yes, I find history romantic.
Mm.
Very important to me to know where I am and why I'm here and why we're here and why the city is like this city.
I'm looking around here and to me it's almost like Georgian minimalism. And Georgian interiors, particularly a middle class interior, was probably relatively minimal.
I think they were.
A huge amount of bits and pieces.
The chairs were put back to the wall, just like I have done.
Mm.
And china was often displayed in china cabinets or corner cupboards. It wasn't necessarily an interior of lots of bits sitting around.
I think it does give enormous credibility to your idea that modernity and the Georgian, or modernity and the classical, are actually very sympathetic.
Yes, they can go together very well.
But it's still very, very blokey.
Well, thank you.
When the classical style, pillars, pediments and porticos took off in this country in the 18th century, it was adopted by powerful tastemakers on the cutting edge of architecture and design. Imagine a time when people had nothing like the choice that we have today. A time when one man could tell you what was good taste and what was not. This is the Burlington Arcade, Piccadilly, London, named after a powerful tastemaker whose taste led Britain for most of the 18th century, and whose views still colour the way that we live today. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Lord Burlington. Lord Burlington is the father of taste, the original tastemaker, the man who really gets everyone talking about taste for the first time. He visited Rome to discover classicism, funded the building of houses, and patronised interior designers, changing forever the way our homes look. Burlington's name dominates Piccadilly, still one of the poshest and most expensive strips in the world. Right next to the Burlington Arcade is Burlington House, now the Royal Academy of Arts. Still setting the agenda for Taste Today, this place was Lord Burlington's home. And it shouted out that simplicity, balance, and proportion were now the new rules of new or neoclassical taste. The great architects and designers of the day lived here. Frederick Handel lived here. It was the place to come, the cultural centre of London. And the first thing that Burlington did was throw up a dirty, great big wall around this building. Right from the very start, taste and neoclassicism in this country is about snobbery, elitism, and being exclusive. To find the new style that would enable Lord Burlington and his circle to move on up the social ladder, he and his friends went on a grand tour of Europe, to Rome, ancient capital of the once vast Roman Empire. This was the place where over 2,000 years ago, architecture had come to represent power and world domination. Here, young aristocrats like Burlington found the perfect model for a new, virile, expanding British Empire, the Roman Empire. With its vast territories, monumental ruins, and sense of civic virtue. Travelling by carriage, Burlington's first grand tour started in 1714 and lasted a year. Lord Burlington made it de rigueur that every truly educated Brit knew the complex set of rules that dictates the arrangement of classical architectural features. Take columns. Plain Doric sits at the bottom. Curly Ionic goes next. And elaborate Corinthian on top. Each represents a different epoch in ancient Greek civilization, which is where the Romans got it from. And they're arranged on a building in the order that they occurred. In the classical world, everything has its place. History in the right order, society in the right order. No wonder class-conscious societies like ours have a continuing love affair with the style. If you want something to be classy, stick on a column. But if you want something to be posh, you'll need to know the right column. Burlington returned to England with 878 trunks, stuffed full of statues, mosaics, and other souvenirs accumulated during his trip. All ammunition for spreading his new classical gospel and establishing the rule of taste.
I think it looks better like that.
Well, basically, I'm a sculptor by trade now and gone backwards and forwards to Rome most of my life, looking at the works of art. And obviously, what can you say? You're always impressed when you go there. You come back with multitudes of ideas.
Here we have a very classical piece. It's a Pandora bust. It fits very well on a scrolled column.
It's classic, it's Italian, it's classic. It's people for hundreds of years have liked classical things in their garden.
Looks very nice in any type of garden. In a small or a large garden, it goes very well.
Years ago, if you were a Roman and you had something in solid marble, you were a very wealthy man. But now it's affordable to everybody.
Also along here, we have a sundial scrolled column. Again, it's a very classical piece.
Well, the Ionic column is a popular column. Well, it's the most classical, perhaps. It's the most widely known of the columns. And you can do so many things with it, you know. You can extend it, you can make pergolas with it. It's a very versatile column to work with in the garden. It does say taste, yes.
And now coming on to, I would probably say, got to be a very famous piece of classical art in history, is the Venus de Milo. Everybody knows it. It's basically a wonderful piece and, well, just looks fantastic, you know. It's wonderful.
Whilst on the Grand Tour, Burlington bumped into a kindred spirit, a man who would eventually become a lifelong companion and collaborator, William Kent. And it's easy to imagine the pair of them in Rome, under the shade of an umbrella pine, fantasizing about how they could take a little of what they saw back to Britain.
William Kent, who started as a semi-literate sign painter from Hull, had more in common with Burlington than just red turbans. They both loved classical style. Burlington, with his cash and connections, introduced Kent to his rich and powerful friends. And Kent went on to become Britain's first interior and garden designer. Saturday sun. But before building houses together, Burlington and Kent did a spot of gardening. And the English garden would never look the same again. Here in this garden in Chiswick, West London, Burlington was the proactive patron and Kent the receptive designer. Burlington's stiff upper lip seems to have relaxed a bit when he met the lowly Kent. Together, they loosened up the whole idea of what a garden should look like. Came without warning. And this is what came before. Plants teased and tortured into fancy Baroque shapes that makes them look like fabric patterns or jewellery. This is the after, the landscaped garden.
Burlington and Kent had an extraordinarily novel idea about gardens, that nature should look almost, well, natural.
Except this is nature with knobs on. So to perfect nature and bring a little romance, they added garden temples. Here's a mini version of the Pantheon in Rome. And there's statues and urns agogo. So much for the garden. What Kent and Burlington had to do next was perfect the recipe for the ideal classical house. So Burlington sets off again on another long trawl to Italy and his mecca, Rome. With him came a huge entourage of artists to sketch the buildings and learn the rules of classical proportion, the essential ingredient for the perfect house. People, keep on learning. Burlington wanted a style of architecture that matched his fashionable new outlook. Rationality and science were replacing religious fatalism. The age of reason was dawning, and the mathematical architecture of the pagan Romans chimed in perfectly with these ideas.
Once more, if you want to have a look about the facade of the Pantheon is the most important example of Roman art that we have in the city.
Leonardo da Vinci's famous drawing, The Vitruvian Man, maps out classical proportion. It shows a perfect man with his arms and legs stretched out, fitting into a square and into a circle. Human bodies were seen as sacred, and so geometric shapes, squares, circles, and triangles, were seen as the ideal basis for architecture. This is all about human proportion, man at the center of the universe. Keep on trying to
Pantheon is just wonderful. It's 2,000 years old. Unbelievable. Rome is a wonderful city where you can find all over, in each corner of the city, these important temples. You agree with me?
Very good. Bravo.
These rules of proportion were rediscovered at the end of the 16th century by the Italian architect Andrea Palladio, Burlington's great hero. Palladio insisted that the only correct way to build was the Roman way, copying the proportions of buildings like the Pantheon in his own designs. The Palladian villa, or house, was born.
To understand Palladio, you have to realise that it was about measuring, copying and counting bricks, removing the random human emotional element that we might see as creativity. You see, Palladio believed that by creating a balanced, measured, ordered space, you could have a balanced, ordered, measured life. Now, before you dismiss that as bonkers, stop and think. We have the same draw today to Feng Shui, an arbitrary set of rules for ordering your domestic space to make your life feel better.
Palladianism is about righteous reason and rigid rules. No place here for human weakness. Keep on trying till I reach my highest ground. Till I reach my highest ground. Back in England, Burlington put those rules into action, building Britain's most faithful Palladian villa, Chiswick House. It's all squares and circles. He's even copied the design and proportions of the Pantheon in Rome for the central section of the house. The puritanical Burlington has created classicism for the purist. But not everyone likes Burlington's strict Palladianism.
Well, very nice to meet you, but what's your problem with Burlington?
It's because we're all brought up to believe it's perfect. It is the ideal architectural style for Britain, and yet it isn't British at all. It's nothing to do with us. It's an imposed alien style. It's a kit of parts, bits from the Pantheon, bits from Palladio, all sort of stuck together in a sort of textbook way. But it has no imagination. I mean, it has this perfection, this symmetry, which is completely alien to us.
Well, let's face it, none of us is symmetrical. There's always a bit that hangs lower than another.
Yeah, and our heads are different.
And Vitruvian man thing.
Doesn't work.
It doesn't work. But isn't it quite nice to aspire to something that's better than us?
Yes. You know, for God's sake, what's the first thing you do when you've bought your council house? You put up a fake Georgian door. You know, it's exactly the same statement on a much smaller scale. This is a statement about being all right, having got there.
Even the size of the windows at Chiswick House is about showing off.
Windows got bigger to let in more light and, of course, allow a view of the garden. But what this is really about is property. It's about being able to see that great, big, gorgeous estate that you owned.
The windows at Tim Whittaker's are his finishing touch in going classical. He's now in the process of putting back Georgian-style sash windows.
I've lived in it as a building site for three or four months and worked on it over the winter, but the windows, the most dramatic thing. Georgian buildings, townhouses are generally so plain and they need their windows back to lift them, and that's what it's done.
We just love you.
Now I see people stopping on their cars to look at it, which is quite interesting. I quite like that.
We just love you. We just love you.
This is our wonderful Latchmore house style, a 3,000 square foot family home with five bedrooms. You'll see the beautiful door casement there, which is the direct influence of the Georgian style.
And the fantastic windows as well.
Formality with the window arrangements. Yeah. We've used sash windows to get the authenticity there. Again, a direct Georgian influence. And as we go into the beautiful entrance hall, you'll just imagine meeting and greeting your guests. In this beautiful hall, which can't fail to impress. If I can just point out a couple of the details.
The contemporary neoclassical house like this one in Hertfordshire is still big business.
And quite sort of Georgian-esque curtain treatment as well.
Yes, indeed. We've got a lot to thank our interior designers for, as far as that's concerned.
Well, that's the entire planner.
And as we go through to the drawing room, you'll see a wonderfully proportioned room. Mm. And again, we've continued the use of the detailed cornice.
Yeah, with the little
of the room.
Egg and dart motif, very Georgian.
Adds to the ambience of the room. Mm. And we've got the French doors, which take you out into the beautifully landscaped rear garden.
And you can survey your domain.
Absolutely, absolutely. So having established that you're going to be doing a lot of entertaining, wonderful double opening doors into a beautiful dining hall. You can see the space that we've dedicated to this room.
Very again, gracious.
Wonderful room.
Very grown up. Dark floor.
Indeed.
Very Georgian.
Indeed. The authentic use of the detailing on the walls as far as the panel effect
yeah.
is concerned.
Yeah.
Again, adds to the feeling, it adds to the atmosphere of the room. You can quite imagine entertaining your guests at a dinner party in this room, certainly.
This is far too posh for my guests. Marvellous. Of course, the hallway in a stately home is always so important, isn't it? It's the impact, it's the
yeah.
way of establishing the style.
But you don't have to live in a neoclassical house to do Georgian. Pat Bettley has a 70s bungalow, but that's not holding her back.
Where do you get your inspiration from?
Books, magazines, television programmes, stately houses. You think, this is our past, and this is how people used to live, surrounded, not ordinary people, but certainly the rich, surrounded by splendour.
Why? What is it about classicism that seduced you in the first place?
School trips.
Right.
School trips when I was a child, because you had a teacher, Mrs. Rose, who was determined we should see things that were better instead of a drab schoolyard. So she hauled you off to places like Blenheim Palace. I'm 11 years old, Blenheim Palace. It was just, a fairyland. I was brought up in wartime Britain. Everything was utility. No one had anything, really. Back streets, toilets at the end of the yard, and a shelter in the garden. So you couldn't be more remote, my child, than what we have now. But it's very nice, actually, when you become into adulthood and you find, I can have something better than what I lived with as a child.
Yeah.
You want better than your parents had. They didn't have a chance ever to have anything that was... Everything was commonplace.
Pat's interior, like Blenheim Palace, could almost be called Baroque, often used as a byword for everything over the top. To understand this British secret love of excess, go to Houghton Hall, the Palladian mansion in Norfolk. This place, a triumph for Lord Burlington's collaborator William Kent, still tells us a lot about who we are today. There's something terribly British about Houghton, like urban terraces, like rows of suburban semi-detached homes, or seas of stony-faced commuters on Waterloo Bridge on a Monday morning. It's stiff upper lip architecture. On the outside, grey, measured, balanced, symmetrical, a facade. Inside, the chill thaws. Curvaceous, indulgent, colourful. It's a personal, private pleasure. But something seems to have gone wrong with the ideal of classical Palladian purity. I'd say this is more Blenheim than Burlington.
All well and good making a grand, restrained statement outside, but does it really work inside? Surely it's the human condition to want to show off to your friends. I mean, where are you going to put your knickknacks? How are you going to demonstrate how well-educated, how wealthy, how fashionable you are? Is that kind of showing off compatible with styles like minimalism? With Palladianism. Inevitably, here at Houghton, Kent and Burlington ended up with something that had more than a whiff of the Baroque to it.
The decorations done in the 1720s show how Kent, despite Burlington's puritanical approach to style, has, like Pat Bettley nearly 300 years later, found colour and ornament, a temptation he cannot resist. Sir Robert Walpole, effectively Britain's first Prime Minister, got Kent to do the interior designs. Humble old Kent, the romancer and reveller who entertained Burlington with his drunken antics, was now at the heart of British political power. This room is all about showing off Walpole's wealth. The mahogany panelled door of the saloon alone is said to have cost £1,000, the equivalent of about £40,000 today. But don't you just want to lick that luscious detailing? Today's love of matching furniture and fabrics was kicked off by Kent, our first dyed-in-the-wool interior designer. It's like I'm going back to my roots. The walls, covered with the same material as the chairs, look exactly like flock wallpaper. And there's a reason for that. Flock was designed to look like fabric. It's made by gluing tiny coloured fibres to paper, and here in North London, Cole and Son still make it the old way.
What the wallpaper industry lacked was the imitation of silk. Decorations on the walls of the very, very big houses was silk damask, which invariably were imported. And of course, they were very costly. So the invention of flock wallpaper became a great factor cost-wise. And of course, you could always copy any of the designs. It could be as much as £600 a roll. But look at some of your fabrics. You're paying £300 and £400 a metre. You get 10 metres of that. So at the end of the day, it's not all that expensive. And on top of that, you've got quality. Absolutely 110% quality. We supply wallpapers, including flocks, to wonderful houses like Buckingham Palace, Balmoral, Woburn, Wilton House, Greenwich Conservatory, the White House in America, various museums throughout Europe.
In the 18th century, the British Empire was expanding and colonialists covered the walls of their embassies and gentlemen's clubs with this stuff. So, when Indian restaurants opened over here, flock, being posh, was the natural choice. We're back in Houghton, in its monumental marble hall with its huge corbels and its elegant monochrome tiled floor. But it's in the staircase where Kent's imagination really runs riot. Trompe l'œil paintings were his main tool. Trompe l'œil means deceive the eye, and that's what Kent does by creating an illusion of depth, a technique that dates back to the Romans.
It's also dramatic. In fact, it's theatrical, which is no surprise considering that Kent was a celebrated stage designer. And here he's used every theatre trick in the book to create false perspectives and make flat surfaces appear three-dimensional. Perhaps it was his theatrical background that inspired Kent to take interior design so much further than it had been taken before. After all, it's about creating a stage for living, a backdrop that reflects who you are or who you'd like to be. The taste that Burlington, Kent and their crew marketed is still a bestseller today. Great, but for them, style was about elegance, quality, refinement and craftsmanship. So the question is, can classicism be successfully repackaged as a mass market item? Like a tin of beans. Well, you decide. The crucial thing is you can shop for corbels as if you were in a supermarket, and you can afford them should you want them. Or an off-the-shelf Roman capital. Classical mantelpieces ready to take home. Houghton's floor on a roll. And panelling is obviously all the rage this season. Trompe l'œil stencils.
But there are still people today doing trompe l'oeil the Kent way. No stencil kits here, just paint and brushes and an eye on the open sky above.
Well, I think decoration generally is all about playing with people's sense of reality or sense of space, their kind of sense of where they are, sort of like theatre. It's, you know, transforming a space from being something really bland and boring into something that's magical.
We're currently having a trompe l'oeil sky painted on the ceiling, which we're hoping will be done in 2 days.
It will be done in 2 days.
The living room obviously is really important because you're spending a lot of your time in your living room. It's very important that it creates
drawing
a sort
room.
Of in your drawing room.
Drawing room or sitting room. Living room is for people who watch Coronation Street, haven't
they? I want to be able to come into this room and lie on the settee and just, you know, look up
I
at
don't
the ceiling.
Do settees. Safer. Safer as all chaise longs.
I think it's very important that people notice the sky and sunsets and things like that. It's important to me.
I never look at the sky, having said that.
Don't you?
No, I don't like outdoors. I'm a sort of indoors, interiors person. The sort of dirty, kind of grey, sort of dismal, depressing kind of sky that sort of suits my character the best. Because I'm more indoors.
Well, a sunny, bright, happy sky suits my character best.
Yeah. Well, you're not having that, so.
I am really, really happy with the way that the room's turned out. I think it's just a very typical sort of English sky. I think this room, I think the whole flat is indicative of my personality. I think it's quite fun and quite sort of dramatic and theatrical, but it's also sort of nice and serene and calm as well. And because of that, I think it's going to be a really lovely room to live in and spend time in. Overall effect, I think, is quite magical, to me anyway.
In 1748, in southern Italy, the discovery of ancient Roman domestic interiors at Pompeii was to make Kent and Burlington's classicism of the 1720s look distinctly out of touch. Pompeii, along with many of its inhabitants, had been buried in ash ever since the volcano Vesuvius erupted in 79 AD. But nearly 1,700 years later, excavations began. A technicolor revolution in British taste was about to take place. Before Pompeii was discovered, neoclassicism had been based entirely on monumental public buildings, palaces and temples, principally in Rome, and their walls had lost most of their paint long ago. By the middle of the 18th century, the English gentleman thought he knew all there was to know about classicism, which is why coming to Pompeii must have been the most extraordinary revelation, because he was a new sort of classicism, a domestic classicism, in all its gaudy, vigorous frivolity, complete with large swatches of Roman wallpaper. How nice for the upper-middle-class grand tourist to come to an upper-middle-class classical home. So they came, they saw, they copied. Look at those rich reds and yellows. The 18th century Brits were agog at this new playfulness. The scrolly patterns, the floating figures, the putti aplenty.
I love the delicacy of these paintings. They're almost impressionistic. They're very unworked, quite get on with it, quite impromptu. Probably done by a Greek slave, they often were. And of course the Vettii who built this house were two brothers, they were freedmen, they started off as slaves and very much nouveau riche. So they're going to want the best Greek slave to paint their walls. Yet again, design used as social propaganda.
I have always been influenced by Italian style, and I love Roman and Greek, you know, the ancient Roman and Greek civilization. So with the corridor, it was a chance to really explore that, you know, in that type of design.
Because of the very sort of strong classical influences and the other elements of the space. I mean, kind of like having a sort of Pompeian mural, sort of fresco type scheme seemed to be the kind of most appropriate, really.
Such was the impact of Pompeii that a new organisation, the Society of Dilettanti, started raising money to send budding young British classicists to the site. And they saw much more than frescoes. They discovered all sorts of novel ways of decorating an interior. Stucco plaster to create the illusion of stone. They saw sculptures. Raunchy Roman homoeroticism. And for the first time, Roman pottery. Round medallions on the ceilings, octagonal medallions with shields, and swooping, scrolly stucco. One man who took advantage of the new discoveries in southern Italy was Robert Adam, who came here in 1758. The ideas he took home were to make him possibly the biggest star of British 18th century interior design. And Adam started in Sion House in West London. An egocentric and self-publicising Scot, Adam's energy and genius eclipsed Kent and Burlington, whose work he dismissed as pompous and ponderous. Classicism's new phase, the Adam phase, was born. Lady Caroline Percy, who lives in Sion House, is a direct descendant of the first Duke of Northumberland, the man who paid Robert Adam to design this interior.
I just see loads and loads and loads of things here which seem to have come straight from Pompeii. Even something like the floor. I mean, there's not a floor like it in Pompeii, but the colours, the kind of the oxbloods and the indigos.
Well, this was the first house that Adam did when he returned from his grand tour, so he was full of Pompeii Roman influence, and this sort of set the tone for the Adam style for future houses.
And the panels up there, these kind of large, swooping foliate shapes, are so like the sort of things that were coming up in Pompeii. I am, however, rather disappointed contrasting what's going on here with what was going on in Pompeii, and this is very unerotic. Pompeii is a riot of rudeness.
Well, there's some quite good-looking nude statues, which were the first, the only nude men I ever saw when I was a child. These men are such magnificent specimens of manhood that one could never, ever find anything to measure up. It's been downhill ever since I was 10 years old.
Can I blag a tour off you?
Yes.
Sion House has belonged to Lady Caroline's family for over 400 years. It was first given to them by James I, so Robert Adam wasn't starting from scratch like Kent and Burlington. He was in makeover land.
Oh, now this is looking very, very familiar indeed. In fact, yeah, Stabian Bars in Pompeii, it was exactly that kind of geometric division of the ceiling. But this is so colourful, it's so, you know, floaty and bright.
It's very friendly.
As if you could just stick it on.
Well, they were painted on cardboard.
Oh, sounds a bit like a makeover.
Well, makeovers, I think, you know, people did want change. Mm. And in fact, I believe Queen Charlotte invited Matthew Bolton in. Mm. To do exactly what you do, a changing room. It's like as if the Queen invited you into Buckingham Palace and said, you know, I want to make my house look like Herculaneum drawing room.
So in my dreams. I could have all the MDF in my kingdom. Oh, again, fishing putti. Those are Pompeii.
Yes.
Also Wedgwood. You know, Wedgwood was the new black, wasn't it?
Yes, it was documented in some history book that the ladies were as mad as March has for Wedgwood vases, and he couldn't produce enough.
And like Fendi handbags, when they came into the shops, there was a queue of ladies waiting outside to buy them. But Adam was clever because he used the best craftsmen of the time. You know, Wedgwood, Bolton, Joseph Rose did the plaster. Chippendale.
So it's like finding the right curtain maker.
Exactly.
Adam's work is sometimes rather dismissively thought of as being a bit stuck on, a bit like self-adhesive neoclassicism. But it was an era of phenomenal change and movement. The manufacturing capacity of mid-18th century Britain was staggering. Suddenly, you could mass produce things like furniture, metalwork, and of course ceramics with Wedgwood, which led to the neoclassical style suddenly becoming available and adored by a much broader audience. Josiah Wedgwood took advantage of the newly discovered vases from Pompeii, and in Stoke-on-Trent, he set up one of Britain's first factories. Wedgwood got the idea in 1769 when he was given a catalogue of Pompeii pot designs. Wedgwood used jasperware clay to produce the Wedgwood look we all know and love. Having started as a run-of-the-mill potter in an unimaginative industry, Wedgwood can be credited as being one of the first people to make money out of designing for the mass market. He harnessed the technological advances of the Industrial Revolution. He made a point of finding out what people wanted and became adept at spotting market trends. All of this he funneled through what we today would recognise as a modern marketing campaign. He made sure that on the mantelpiece of every celebrity, you'd find a Wedgwood vase. Wedgwood sold lifestyle. Today, top fashion designer Jasper Conran, son of lifestyle czar Terence Conran, is designing his own jasperware for Wedgwood.
What I've tried to do here is to make a range of products from Wedgwood, from this British tradition, that doesn't throw the tradition away, but makes it relevant to a new market. I think it's a neat conceit, the idea that it's called jasperware and I'm called Jasper. It's very irresistible, of course. I'm gagging to do it. You mean, do I put sort of neoclassical scenes on the side? I was never tempted to put columns on. I don't suppose the person that has a Wedgwood vase would have necessarily a Jasper Conran jug, but they might have a teapot. I think that Josiah would be proud of it. I think he'd like it.
By the 1770s, with empire and industry generating huge wealth, Josiah Wedgwood was cashing in on Britain's new hobby, shopping. A marketplace offering many styles was just around the corner, but these were the glory days of neoclassical taste. And where did those 18th century shoppers put their vases? Where you do today, on the mantelpiece.
What symbolises cosy British domesticity more than the mantelpiece, covered with knick-knacks, family photographs and vases? In fact, its roots lie far from Britain. For a start, most fireplaces have the same proportions on a reduced scale as a Roman temple. As an architectural feature, it received the same kind of treatment as a Renaissance palace, with vases, urns or statues arranged symmetrically on top. Within the Roman home, the two most sacred elements were the hearth and the larium, a temple-shaped shrine dedicated to the worship of the family ancestors. I'm fascinated by what I think is an echo of that tradition. Think about it. Look at your fireplace. That's where you've got your family photographs. That's where you've got your most important, most valued, most prized possessions. It's the fireplace that's now the emotional heart of the room. Our classical inheritance is, to be sure, much more than heritage. It's a state of mind, a living thing. And one of Britain's most interesting architects today, coincidentally called Robert Adam, is out to show that the modern and the classical can work together. This is Solar House on the Hampshire-West Sussex border, a solar-heated, contemporary, classical home. My life in the sunshine. Everybody loves the sunshine. Sunshine. Would you describe Solar House as a classical structure or a modern structure?
Well, it's both.
Right.
No contradiction between the two. Modern, in the proper sense of the word, just means something that's been built fairly recently or done fairly recently. And the classical is as capable of being modern as anything is capable of being modern.
What about the posh thing and classicism?
Yes, it's interesting. There is a sort of assumption, particularly among the denigrators, that it's all A, about power, and B, about status. A lot of people, particularly with their own houses, see it in that way. They see it, you know, stuff a portico on, I'm a big knob, really, you know, that kind of thing.
And it seems to be that the majority of people in this country would associate their culture with classicism.
Yes, people identify with traditional things, and classical architecture is not the only tradition, but it's probably the dominant tradition, if one people understand. Yeah. Folks
get brown in the sunshine. Classicism is a rule book, and there are plenty of people that want to live within the rules. There are also plenty of people that want to make taste up as they go along. But if classicism shows the British at our most restrained, our most repressed, even snobbish, don't forget that its roots lie in a faith that humanity can tame and understand the world. A faith, dating back to the ancients, that man can be a god. Just bees and things and flowers.